sebagai struktur tahan gempa pada berbagai kejadian gempa kuat, mulai dari gempa di Yogyakarta tahun 2006 sampai dua kejadian gempa kuat terakhir, 2 September 2009 di Jawa Barat dan 30 September 2009 di Sumatera Barat. Jika dibandingkan dengan sistem konvensional yang banyak mengalami kerusakan berat dan bahkan keruntuhan. Seiring perkembangan zaman, produk pracetak dituntut untuk memiliki kualitas yang lebih baik lagi dari segi penampilan, pemasangan yang lebih presisi dan rapi, serta pelaksanaan yang lebih memperhatikan keselamatan dan keamanan kerja dan sistem manajemen lingkungan. Untuk meningkatkan kemampuan sumber daya manusia dalam aspek-aspek tersebut, IAPI bekerjasama dengan PUM Nederland mendatangkan tenaga ahli yang telah 40 tahun berpengalaman dalam industri pracetak untuk membina para pelaksana Indonesia agar mampu membuat produk pracetak yang lebih baik.
Hello, I'm Dick Stol. I'm a civil engineer from the Netherlands. And it's now my third time in Indonesia for exchange of knowledge between your country and my country. This exchange we had with IAPI, with JIS and other precast firm. And we had a very pretty discussion and the idea grew to make a movie how to make a good precast. So let's start and have a look. Good production process to have perfect product in precast, the check on incoming materials is very important. As the aggregates are really the most important materials that are incoming to our factory, we have to pay a lot of attention to it. So taking a monster of all new materials that come to our factory is part of the standard routine to make good products. Especially for the sand, we have to take even more care because it's very difficult to take out those small plump parts. And if you find a stone like this in our sand, it will show that our supplier doesn't pay enough attention to his sieves, because this one shouldn't be here and it can cause some problems when you are filling your molds. So, it shouldn't happen too often. It's aggregates form 80% of our concrete mixture, so they are very important for us. The aggregates are important to make the best concrete mixture. What's very important is that aggregates are clean, so pieces of wood or leaves, for instance for the trees above this, have to be taken out. So after some storm, just watch carefully for the leaves coming from the trees. You have to divide the different sizes of aggregates you are using. In this case we see that the smaller aggregates are mixing with the bigger ones, and it's better to have a division wall here so that they won't mix, because it will be very difficult to make a good mixture with particles of aggregates that you can't identify anymore. then we have to take care of sand. We see a little bit of grass growing in the sand over there. And if you go to the smaller particles of gravel, we have to look carefully because aggregates have to be clean, but they can contain particles like clay or mud, and those particles are not good for a good sound concrete mixture. I can show you. When I take out some of this split material, you will see that there is a lot of fine materials, of fine stuff, stays in my hand when I throw it away. This is a reason to do more testing on the materials to see if the fine materials are not more than our norms will accept. The quality of the aggregates is very important for the quality of the concrete itself. So before we can start mixing the concrete, we must know how the particles in the aggregates are divided. Because then we can mix sand and gravel in the right proportions. This is done by taking examples from our yard and bring them first in that oven to dry them, so that we can use the sieves to find the how the particles are divided. Because, and we can find the percentage, we are looking for the percentage of material that stays above a certain sieve. If we do that for as well gravel as sand, we can create a mixture by calculating where it should be. And what we are doing is trying to find a mixture between two lines that are in the scheme over there. After drying and sieving the sand, the sieves are on a vibrator to do the sieve well, we have a scale to find out those rests on the different sieves. We do some other tests as well. We test the amount of mud or clay in it, because it's only for small amounts acceptable. And we do tests to find out if there are plant rests in the aggregates, because they can be harmful for the concrete itself. So that is what we here doing in a laboratory, and we have to do it before we can start the whole production process of mixing, casting and demolding and the stockyard, what we all are going to do. So somewhere this is the center of our concrete industry. As soon as we have the results of the sieve test and we know the division of particles of the sand and the gravel, we can start to create the mixture. What we have to take care for is that the mixture, because we have here a line of the sieves, and the vertical line is the line of the percentages of the materials that stays on the sieves, we have to create a mixture between some of these lines. There are three areas you can choose of. What area you choose has to do with the quality of the concrete and the cement you are using in the mixture, how much of cement you have to add to the mixture. But by creating a line in between here, you will have a good division of all particles that can be glued by the cement. So that's how you make a sound concrete. The production of beams and columns start with the construction of the reinforcement. Before we can construct the reinforcement, we have to cut the bars in the right length. We use for that reason this steel cutter. We have to bring a stopper at the right length of the bar and cut the bar, and then we have to check the length of the bar and make some adjustments when needed, so that we are sure that we have the right length of the bars. If we see this process running, we can give some suggestions for improvement. Why not bring the machinery on a level you can look at the bars easier, and so bring it on the table and have a stopper that can be fixed, like a steel stopper on a bar that you can fix with a screw simple at the same position, because the chance that the stopper will change its position and you won't see it is there, and you can bring improvement giving the steel a gutter so that you can bring it simple in the right position. Now we have cut the bars in the right length, we can start to produce the ring bars with it. First of all, the measurement width and length of the ring bars are drawn on the machinery. We use this type of machinery, but we can do it by hand as well. We just have to look at the right diameter of the middle of the machinery. The machinery functions like this. It does all the work we are doing. We can do by hand, by machinery, so we don't need the force to do it, and we can pay more attention to the quality of the work we are doing. And again, after finishing these ring bars, there should be a check if they are in the right dimension, because now you have time to make correction when needed. How important it is to check your dimensions at your first production, we can see now. Because if we see this ring reinforcement, there is a difference in the width of 16 up to 14.5 centimeters. That shouldn't be there. So now we have to make corrections to produce ring reinforcement in the right dimensions. Yes, because when you can see when we have to bring in the reinforcement bars, we will have something like this. And then we can see that it's not rectangular as it should be. So we have to make these corrections, and they will do it, and it's only the first production, so we will produce at the right dimensions after our correction. If we look at this machinery now, it should be better to have the original devices to fix the measure in the machinery than this one, because this can vary with the thickness, the diameter of the bars you are using there. The whole process we do is bending the first, do the first bending. Now we come measuring to the second bending. The third one, take care of the right dimensions now. We now do 1, 2, 3, 4, the 6th bending first, because otherwise we can't make it. And we can do the 5th bend, the 4th bending. And check the dimensions again. On the first side it looks a lot better now. But you can check it. It's I will do it for you. The width 14.5. 14.5, it should be 14.5. You should know. And if you look, if it's rectangular, it's 35.5. You can take this one, I think it's 35, so there is still a minimum deviation. 35, I think it's all right. When 14.5 is the measurement you should make for the width and the height of the upper bars, and then we will go to the lower bars. And he is using bindraad to make the connection. He makes a double bindraad connection. And use the kniepex also to cut the bindraad. That at the end of beams or columns, the distance between the ring bars can vary. Most of the time they are closer to each other than in the middle of the beam, where the distances are bigger. So let's pay attention of the drawings we are using and bring the ring bars in exactly at the position that we have in our drawing. Here we are at the mold where we produce the beams. It's a beam with two U-shells at the ends. So there has to be added when after we have to bring in the reinforcement, they add those parts that are standing there as well. At this moment he is oiling the beam. It's very important to use a small layer of the mold oil. But otherwise we can damage the element when we take it after production out of this mold. It's a mold with a fixed middle. That's fixed to the bottom of it. And there are two side molds that you can take away on both sides. And what's very important is that the side boats close very narrow to the bottom, because if you have leakage of fine particles, the surface of this element you are going to produce at the corners will be less than we want it to be. You see that it's very important to have a smooth surface. Because of that, you see some reparations in this mold where they have been welding in the past, and they have been filling it with a filler and grinding it so that we have a smooth surface. If you look closer to the mold, we see how important it is to be critical in your view on it. Supports of this part of the mold are not in one line. It can move during casting and will create tolerances that we don't like to have, because we like to have the tolerances as small as possible. And this can be improved, and they will do it, I think, at this moment now. Of the concrete, we use a vibration needle. It's not meant to transport the concrete, but it will compact the concrete very well, so that we can take all the air bubbles out of the concrete. We have to turn these pipes so the concrete won't have connection with it, and within 4 hours we have to take out the pipes so that we will have an opening to connect this column to the column under it. I'm standing here in front of some elements that already had their first curing. But it's good to make some remarks about the good way of curing of the elements. First thing we have to do is to prevent the water to go out of the concrete, because it's needed for the reaction with the cement. So the cement will need all the water that's in the concrete. So what we can do to it, we can keep the element wet for the first part of days after casting, or we can cover the element so that the water can't go out. The other solution is use a curing compound. You can spray a curing compound on the element, so it will keep the water in the element and give the best quality of concrete. Yesterday we left the element for curing. It's curing during the night, and it will take about 18 hours. The curing depends on temperature and time. They both take care of the right strength to demold the columns and beams, which we will do today now. We can do that with a device like the Schmidt hammer. It's a non-destructive instrument to check the element itself. Or we can do it by testing a cube or a cylinder that is cured, has been cured under the same circumstances as the element itself. If we find that the strength is enough, we can demold the product itself. Now we can see the surface of the element, and as we see, there are some air bubbles in this surface that need repair. It's better to produce elements that don't need repairs anymore, so they have to be more carefully with the surface of their mold, with the oil, with the mixture and the vibration. Those can all influence the quality of this surface. Now this element will go to repair, I think. There is a simple way to check if the voids are really open. You just do it by hand. seen that the elements are repaired. An important issue with these elements is that you support them in the right way. I can say 1/5, 3/5 and 1/5, or in another way use the lifting points as a point where you can put your supports. In these two elements they have done that correctly. Another thing is they repaired them, but we have to realize that the element is still low, and if I feel here there is still some of those repair mortar under it, so it's better to have the reparations on supports at about this height, so at the same time you can take that off with a grindstone and have a fine product. In the stockyard we find another type of product. These are facade elements that are used in the facades of a big building. There is a window frame in it with a beam above the window, and on the other side we find steel plates to weld the facade to the concrete construction of the building. It's very important to keep these products in vertical position because people are working in between these elements to give it the last finishing to bring them to the building site. In the end, we are going to transport our elements to the building site. There are important rules for that, because we have to take care that the elements will not be damaged during the transport. So they must be connected or fixed to a rack like this, that they can't be damaged. And there is another important rule: they should be a danger to other users of your roads, so they mustn't come off during the transport, even when the truck has to brake fast because of a traffic jam or is going through deep pieces of the road with a lot of water you can't find. It must be all in order. And when they do, we deliver a very good product to our building sites. Now we come to the end of this movie, which was quite an experience for me. I hope that the whole process we showed in steps will support you by making a good, producing a very good precast concrete product. I thank you very much. Because you can't, it's not easy to move, that's why they have to take it out earlier. I like to know, because you say 6 hours after casting you found out that was the best way to do it. If you do it earlier you will have cracks.
The reparations you are only doing after mounting the elements in the facade, because there are elements standing over there, and but there is no repair there. You do it in the facade itself. You see the problem with steel blocks is they always they can't help it. But you will see where they are welded. All the time, you see it back in all the elements, and they all have to repair that. They have to finish it like that. But you are still seeing where the welds of the mold are. It's very difficult. We try to smoothen the mold by just like you repair an auto car. It's with. I don't know the word, plamure is the word, yes? Yeah. But it, for instance, when you heat the mold, it will come back. So we tried to buy big plates, so that you have only one plate for an element. They do a lot of reparations all the time. It's you shouldn't do that, I think, but even you can do without tiles to make these stairs in very good concrete, but you see there is a lot of repairs and it's not quite straight now. They will repair it, but it's a waste of because in the future those repairs will show. You already see that the plastering is not quite flat, it's not smooth. So, and you have the same problem here, I think. It's very difficult to have it in the best condition for them, but they do the best, I'm sure of that.
If you see building sites like this, and this is not the only building site I've seen in this type of building, there is a lot of they have to repair. For instance, the joint between those two elements and the underside, in our country, there wouldn't be repair because we would have made a fee joint on the underside, and the elements would have closed. You saw already here a problem I mentioned yesterday, because on one of the pictures is the joint, where was it, between those half slabs with a lot of reinforcement. Oh, here it is. There's far too much reinforcement there to have a sound connection. It's not to blame the contractor, but it's somewhere in the design, I think. And as a contractor, you should talk it over with the designs. And on the other hand, you have to realize when you are sitting in the position that I am, I can look along the construction of the beam that's on the outside of the corridors. And I can tell you, it's not quite one line. We have to improve that, as we have to improve, because in these type of buildings, you won't find a joint to have a new level. So you will find that there are differences in height sometimes. And what I think it's very difficult, the number of reparations, and even if they fill the joint, they create repairs, because I'm very sorry for you, but it's common, but you have to repair still a lot, and you do that because labor is cheap here. But at the same time, I think you could have a better quality and make it possible in the future to produce elements that are just clean. So you never have to, so repair should be not common, but should be once sometimes in a building, and not all the times that are you in there. Because repairs like this, I can understand, because they are to fix the columns. But what you repair there, and at the same time, you see it's very difficult to have it so smooth that you can't see it anymore. You work it over, and you stay repairing all the time. And there is, in my opinion, repairs are of less quality than the concrete that's compacted. That's one. The second thing for you is repairs cost money, and you can't calculate these costs very well. Yeah, so there are not an advantage for you. And then, if you enter this building site, when you look at the stack of that was inside between those buildings of the elements that still have to be mounted, you can improve that, I think. And what you can improve is to clean. You have to dig these holes, I understand, but if you know that you have to bring waste materials outside, don't wait for it later, because as soon as they are away, the better it's for the safety in your building, but the better it is to make a good product. I'm sorry to make these remarks, but I came here to make these remarks because it's, they asked me to do that. Normally, we should talk it over ourselves and not with the whole group, but we should. I think they know that that's my position at this moment, so they won't blame you, because it's I've seen the same thing on a lot of your building sites already 3 months ago, and different contractors, and you are not negative compared to them. So please, I apologize for that. I hope you accept my apologies.
Sampai itu kita juga sudah mempunyai peta yang dikeluarkan oleh Badan Geologi SDM. Tapi dari peta-peta itu daerah mana termasuk apa namanya rawan, jadi ada yang masuk apa ya kategori 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 itu ada semua. Nah, kalau misalnya satu tempat masuk juga kategori 6, itu berarti sudah sangat tinggi. Artinya mungkin itulah di pusat gempa. Nah, sekarang kita juga sudah punya standar SNI untuk menghadapi yang seperti itu. Masalahnya tinggal kita ini disiplin nggak mengikuti SNI-SNI yang sudah kita keluarkan. Jadi lokasi-lokasi mana yang punya potensi gempa besar kita sudah tahu. Kemudian SNI kita juga sudah mempunyai. Cuman begini ya, kalau misalnya SNI rumah sederhana tahan gempa, jangan dipikir digoyang-goyang nggak runtuh. Ya, tentu saja runtuh. Cuman masalahnya kalau rumah tahan gempa itu kalau runtuh masih memberi kesempatan yang punya rumah bisa keluar dulu. Tidak mengejar gitu, tapi ya masih pelan-pelan atau paling tidak ada waktu untuk penghuni itu bisa keluar.